Our next guest or speaker is Paul Mahern, and I'm just going to read what he sent me in terms of his bio information as soon as I get there. Paul burst onto the American music scene in 1979 as the 17-year-old singer for seminal hardcore punk band The Zero Boys. The band was known nationwide for its intense live performances, but it was their debut album, Vicious Circle, that remains a punk rock staple to this day. During his days in the Zero Boys, Paul was drawn to the other side of the glass and started learning about the production aspects of record making. He began by recording punk, hardcore bands local to the Midwestern United States. After a few years of paying his dues in and around Indy, Paul made a move to Bloomington, Indiana, where he started working with major label acts like the Blake Babies, the Judy Bats, and Mysteries of Life. Did they record for Berliner? I just seemed to... Maybe not. All right. Excuse me. Paul's years of solid production work and deep ties to the Indiana music community eventually attracted the attention of local and international music legend John Mellencamp, who now works primarily with Paul as his recording engineer. Most recently, they undertook an exciting project for Mellencamp's No Better Than This album by touring the company with co-producer T-Bone Burnett to record in legendary rooms with a single 1950s reel-to-reel tape deck and one microphone. The astounding results have garnered praise from the music press and recording community alike. Always open to learning more about his field, Paul worked for 2 years at Indiana University on the NEH-funded Sound Directions project at the Archives of Traditional Music, and it was there that Paul was lead engineer on an IU and Harvard University co-authored paper on best practices for audio preservation. His work there involved all aspects of transferring analog sources to the digital realm, including everything from restoration and repair of old tapes and discs to digitization and metadata management. Paul is owner-president of Mahern Audio Engineering Incorporated, Mahern Archival Presentation, and owner-manager of White Arc Studios in Bloomington, Indiana. Please join me in welcoming Paul Mahern. The recording you were just listening to was done by John Mellencamp in Sun Studios in 2009 using this one Ampex 601 recorder and RCA 44 microphone in that particular date. I'll start my story talking a little bit about myself. This is really about my journey through my life as a recording engineer, and most importantly, as a fan of recorded music. I was born in 63, so in 69, I really became aware of music in my house. There was always music in my house, but no one in my family was really a musician. We just listened to a lot of records. I had 5 teenage brothers and sisters, and we listened to a lot of Beatles records and Rolling Stones records and Hendrix records. And just seeing the way that they reacted to the recorded music, it just fascinated me. It made me realize that, you know, this was really cool. The teenagers love music, they love recordings, and so I was started on my journey. My first band in high school, and I entered the recording studio for the first time in 1979, little basement studio, Tascam, half-inch, 8-track, and I was just blown away. I fell in love immediately with that technology, that magnetic recording technology. I started making records myself in 1981. I made a lot of punk and hardcore records. I was a collector of punk music, not just in my record collection, but I decided that what I wanted to do was get the bands that were friends of mine from the Midwest and make compilation records. So I got an internship at a studio in Indianapolis, and I started bringing my friends in, people from Chicago and Milwaukee and Ohio, and I made a couple of compilation albums, one called The Master Tape, the other one called Master Tape Volume 2, and it's just very simple. I mean, punk records are made live. Everybody plays live. If there's any overdubs, it's the lead guitar and maybe a background vocal or so. In the 90s, I started making more complex records for bigger budgets. In 98, I first started working with Mellencamp. And John and I have made probably about seven or eight records together. And I think one of the reasons that we get along is that we're both huge fans of recorded music. John has probably 2,000 records in his collection. And the way he communicates in the studio with the musicians and with me is by cross-referencing. So if he's looking for a particular sound, he'll just say, you know, play that Stones record. That's the acoustic guitar sound I want. And then it's my job and the guitar player's job to figure out, you know, what the tuning is, you know, where the capo was, what the microphone might have been. And this is the way he communicates. I did my first Pro Tools session in 1999, and this is where things started to go downhill. All of a sudden there was a computer, and the job really changed. It got harder for the engineer and easier for the musicians. Now I was responsible for editing performances, for tuning performances, and it really took the fun out of the whole thing. So I saw that IU placed an ad for a job at the Archives of Traditional Music, and I thought, I need a break from the studio life, and I took this job as the audio engineer on the Sound Directions project, and it got simple again. It was just me and some old tape machines, figuring out the best way to digitize these old objects, tapes, discs, etc. And I spent many hours listening to some amazing field recordings. One of the first collections that I transferred was the Alan Merriam recordings that were made in the Congo in 1951-1952. These recordings were made on a tube, full track tape machine, quarter inch, reel to reel tape machine, with one microphone. And I was just really struck by the quality of these recordings. I mean, a lot of the stuff that was coming off of instantaneous discs, there was a lot of noise. I mean, I still love those recordings, but this was hi-fi recording. I'll play you a piece. This will show you the recorder that he used and also the microphone that he used. Clearly high quality recordings.
Yo, yo, yele, yo, yole.
So John Mellencamp called me in 2009, and he told me he wanted to make a new record. He was going on tour with Bob Dylan and Willie Nelson. They were going to be playing baseball stadiums across the United States. And what he wanted to do was make a record while he was on the road. And he wanted to use the oldest equipment available. He wanted to make these recordings in historic locations. And this was very thrilling to me. Felt like I was ready for this gig. No Pro Tools. So I knew I wanted to avoid lathes and cylinders and wires. John is not the most patient man, and I thought that I would be hedging my bets to stay in the realm of magnetic tape. So, you know, my experience at the ATM had showed me that I could make a really great recording with great color in this format, the 7-inch reel traveling at 7.5 IPS. mono quarter-inch tape machine. So I put the question to the ARSC list. I got on the ARSC list and I asked the fine members of the ARSC list what they would use to make this recording. And Jim Atkins was the first one to suggest the Ampex 601. And this is the Ampex 601 right here. Very sexy tape machine. You can see it comes in a little suitcase. I carried it here on the plane, just went right through security with it and stored it in the overhead. This recorder, the particular one right here, I think was made in 1955. Supposedly they were made from the mid-50s to the 60s. We bought three of them on eBay for about $200, $250 a piece. But they all needed work. So we have a great tech in Bloomington, Indiana. His name is Mike Stucker, and he's great with old equipment. So he took them apart. They rebuilt the motors, changed all the capacitors and the tubes. The felts were reconditioned, and all the internal mechanisms were cleaned and relubed. Also, we decided we would add a second output. We decided that it might not be the most stable machine as far as the transport went. So what we wanted to do was be able to pull a direct line off of the preamp so that we could record directly from the preamp to another source at the same time that we were recording to the machine itself. So we set up to test in Bloomington. John owns a building in downtown Bloomington, and we decided we better test this first. And even though John had already told us he wanted to make this with the simplest, oldest equipment, we were a little scared by that. So even on the test day, we showed up with tons of equipment. Here's some pictures of the test recording day. You can see that there's some Neumann microphones, and there's even a Pro Tools rig and lots of preamps. But we ended up falling in love with the sound of the 77, the RCA 77, through the 601. Now, I've owned a pair of 77s since the mid-90s, and I'll have to say that I never heard this microphone until I heard it through this preamp. The sound was so much richer than I'd ever experienced this microphone before. So, let me see if I can play you a piece of that test recording from the device itself.
When everything so hard has been handed to you.
Just really impressed by the way that this single microphone captured those two guitars in voice and also captured the sound of the room. Just the amount of bottom end and depth to the guitars was fascinating. So we decided that we had our method, that we were going to record with this one tape machine and the one microphone. So the first thing we did was we went to a church in Savannah, Georgia, the first African Baptist church built in the 1850s by freed slaves. This is the first brick and mortar building owned by African Americans in Georgia. The setup was simple. One RCA 77DX and just the Ampex tape machine. John on acoustic guitar and vocals, and his guitar player Andy York on acoustic guitar. Now we did run a laptop running Pro Tools as a safety backup. Here's a recording.
it's not my nature to be nostalgic at all. I sat by the phone last night waiting for you to call. It's been decades since I spoke to you. I just wanted to say I've been thinking.
I think you can get a real sense of the ambience of the room from that recording. Next stop, Sun Studios, birthplace of rock and roll. Continuing with the same method, but now introducing several more musicians. John and Andy, again, Mark Rabeau on guitar, electric guitar, Dave Rowe on bass, J.A. Bellarose on drums, and T-Bone Burnett, the producer, on guitar as well. We brought much more gear and still used one microphone. You know, again, we're trained that technology makes things easier and better and safer, most importantly. So T-Bone's engineer and I, Mike Persante, had a discussion and we decided that we better bring enough microphones to cover all these instruments. The problem is that Sun Studios is a museum. So you can't just set up for 2 or 3 days in their space, bring in all this equipment, and leave it set up. So what we had to do is we had to rent a truck that we could set up out back so that we had kind of a control room area out back. So this is the truck full of vintage equipment. You can see that there's a Studer 827 there in the background. That was our backup tape. Some more pictures of the equipment. You know, probably the biggest expense of this recording was all the equipment that we carted to this session and rented that we didn't end up using. But you can see in this picture here, we've got everything mic'd up, but I swear to you, it's only the one microphone you're gonna hear. Recognize the slapback that we're hearing in that recording. What's going on there is we decided to take both outputs of this tape machine. So you're hearing the direct out of this tape machine going to the Studer, and then you're also hearing the repro head coming off of this. So this device was also became our slapback device. And this is the monitor that we used. So the 601 kind of has a brother piece that goes with it, same size. It's an Ampex 602. Amazing. 620. Okay, here we go. And this thing looks and sounds amazing. And we would always set this up for John and the band to listen through. I mean, it just created great vibe, and it sounds amazing. So the second day at Sun Studios, we lost our drummer, so we recorded without drums. This is one of my very favorite recordings that we made for this record. You know, listen to the slapback and the rhythm here. I just love how the slap bass with the delay propels that track. Okay, oh yeah, they were making a movie as well. Kurt Marcus was filming all this on Super 8. Okay, one last stop. I got to move it along here. So we went to San Antonio, Texas. We went to the Gunther Hotel, room 414, where Robert Johnson supposedly made his first recordings. Musicians, John, Andy, and John's guitar violinist, Miriam Sturm, joined us. We set up in the corner of the room because that's where we heard that Robert Johnson set up. and it was one amazing sounding corner. But one thing that we noticed right away, or John noticed, he was like, there's no way there was carpet in this room back then. So we had to bring in some parquet dance flooring from the hotel and put it down on the floor. And we set up, there's our control room next door. So this is Mike Stucker, our tech, and that's me, obviously, and the tape machine, the star of the show. Mike traveled with us the whole time. I mean, he really babied these tape machines the whole time. So supposedly we were set up just like Don Law in the room next door.
Here's a recording.
Okay, yeah, you can really hear the ambience of the space in that recording. Okay, this is what the critics said. People loved it. I'll go on. What I learned, John Mellencamp is fearless. He really kept saying, no, too much stuff. We're going to do this. It's going to work. And he was right. Also, great recordings are made by great musicians, not fancy equipment. Audio recordings transcend time and space. For me, this is really about a journey through time and space. Going to these historic locations, using this old equipment, it really made me think about magnetic recording and how it really brings you into a moment beyond the moment that you're in. Too much digital limiting hurts your ears. So I had this profound experience. I make modern records. I'm as guilty as anybody of making records as loud as they can be, because that's what my clients want. But I had this experience after we did the first recording in the church. I was dry. You know, this is the way records should be made. I felt like this was a great payback for all those years of working really hard. Thank you. Yes, this is released on vinyl. Yes.
We have time for questions if anybody has some.
Do you think that there's any kind of a return to this besides what you did, or is everybody just kind of resigned to digital?
No, there are people that do this on a regular basis, some you know, that I've heard of, people that are very interested in these older recording techniques. And since then, I've made a couple of recordings. I just finished a record by a group called Reverend Peyton's Big Damn Band, where they do all Charlie Patton songs. It was recorded the same way. Same recorder, same microphone. Yes, in the red?
Let's ask a dirty question.
Well, okay, so as far as mastering goes, I did not attend mastering. I am positive that it went from analog tape in the mastering process into, it turned digital right there. And I imagine, but I don't know this for sure, that probably the vinyl was cut from the digital master. Yes?
I hate to be a downer for such a worthwhile project, but that room that supposedly Robert Johnson recorded in, that's no longer the room. The hotel has been altered so much that is not the original space. You may be in the same general area of the fourth floor that ARC recorded in, but the walls have been moved and there's been alterations made. I know because I talked to the hotel people.
Yeah, that's exactly what we heard. But, you know, we were there for the spirit of it. You know, and I feel like we really felt the spirit of Robert Johnson when we made these recordings.
Not to mention the many, many other illustrious artists who recorded in that space.
Yes.
He wasn't the only guy.
Yeah.
Was there. That's true.
Anyone else?
Did we hear more of the...
You can... Of the tape? Oh, I'll play... Can I play just another? All right.
Sure.
This tape's
about to end anyway, so. And my aces won't play. Well, I'm moving down.
Is there another verse to this song?
There was a little, there's a hook line in the middle that we ran over.
Yeah.
And there's also that sort of chorus and a half at the...
Nice, Paul.